him so much for the mothers that he's given each of us.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you.
Darkness, my God, that is who you are. You may have a seat if you'd like. Welcome to Sunday morning at Leeds First United Methodist Church. We're here to praise Jesus. We say this is the Easter season, and we're celebrating every day, every Sunday, the resurrection of Jesus. And so we're going to do that through some song. We're going to do that through some time of prayer, through reading scripture, and closing with Holy Communion. So I invite you to just participate in all the different ways that we engage. When the song, the words are on the screen, sing out loud. We pray along, and just worship with us. We also want to extend a happy Mother's Day to the mothers and those that are here because your mother brought you. Those are good things, and so we're here to be a part of that as well. A couple of things that might be helpful to you is there's a worship bulletin. Inside is some information about what we'll be talking about today and in ways you can connect beyond worship on the rest of the week. Those are on the table that's got a black tablecloth at the back of the seating area. There's also a Connect card, and on that you can share or update your contact information. And on the back of that's a place that you can share, hey, I'd like to have more information or even a prayer concern. You can drop that Connect card in the giving box that's to the right of the doors. You come and go from the gym today. There's also one in the lobby, and you can drop in that same box your gifts and your tithes and your offerings. You may also mail those to the church office or go online. The addresses are on the screen and give that way. I thank you for your partnership in giving to help our mission to create paths for more people to know and grow like Jesus. I'm going to pray for us, and I'm going to invite you to stand in just a moment to continue worship through song. God, thank you so very much. Thank you that it is a resurrection Sunday, that Jesus is in fact risen. And so we celebrate that today. God, I pray that you would also be a blessing to moms, to those that are celebrating moms today. God, I pray that in this service, you'll hear our offering of praise, that you'll be glorified, and that you will work in this service to transform us as we grow closer to you. Pray all this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. I invite you, if you would, to stand and continue in worship and song.
World, his blood breaks the chains, and every knee
stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb, the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chain, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow. Thank you.
come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of
much for the treasure you've given us in the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And we thank you. We thank you, God, and for those moments at the altar, for those moments right now, we're being drawn closer to you. God, reach out, draw us into you, and give us the courage to step towards you when you call. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Hey, you may be seated if you'd like. Shout out to our hospitality team. I think the Krispy Kreme donuts were within the hour from when they were hot off the thing this morning. So if you didn't get a donut, they may be gone by now. I don't want to overpromise, but thanks to the worship team for leading us in song this morning, worship through song, and the tech team. It's a good day to be in God's presence and with His people. And if you're watching online, welcome amongst us. We're here, just to celebrate Jesus this morning. My name is Chris Stallings. It's my privilege to get to be pastor here at Leeds First United Methodist Church. We're in the season of Easter, and we're in part four of a series I've entitled Risen. And Easter brings with it some kind of occurrences or things that follow because of Him being risen. There's hope. There's purpose. There's a future both in this life and for eternity. And that's all centered on the fact that He's risen through it all. And so in this series, we're in part four today, we're looking at different ways that that power of the resurrected Jesus impacts our lives. We've got a key verse. If you want to, look at the screen, or you might flip open your phone or look along with me there. But it comes from Romans 1:4. And it reads, "He was shown to be the Son of God when He was raised from the dead by the power of the Holy Spirit. He is Jesus Christ, our Lord." And so based on that fact, we're looking at this series today. We're risen, or Jesus rather, is risen to give us life, to give life, risen to give life. Well, do you remember the most exhilarating moment of your life? Think about it. What was an exhilarating moment? Some of you have lived full lives. Some of you have multiple moments, right? So I thought it'd be fun if we just get those out now and you share. So on the count of three, I want to invite you to just shout out your most exhilarating moment in life. Ready? On the count of three. One. Wait, just a minute. Some of y'all got to clean up some of your exhilarating moments here. Don't shout those in church. But no, on the count of three, exhilarating moment. One, two, three. Getting married. Yeah, you saw me doing that to my wife, right? Yeah. If you didn't say getting married, we're going to do it again. Or maybe, no. Well, what was your most exhilarating? Was it your wedding day? Was it maybe your graduation or your first paycheck? Do you remember that? Like the first time you had money that was yours? That's pretty exhilarating, right? Because mom and dad never got you enough. Maybe it's the birth of a child. Maybe it was that child's graduation from either kindergarten or high school or college. Maybe it was that child finally moving out of the house. Amen? No. Maybe it was in your spiritual journey when you were baptized, when you put your faith in Jesus. Or maybe it was a kind of physical exhilarating moment, like the first time you drove a car 100 miles an hour. And you, no, don't raise your hand. Well, you can. Or skydiving. As I think about my top five most exhilarating moments, maybe in no particular order, one of them is driving a car really fast. And in order not to incriminate myself, I'm not going to say how fast, but that was fun. One of them was marrying my wife. One of them is getting to be my daughter's dad. One of them was my baptism. And one of them was the first time I rappelled off of a side of a mountain. Like that moment where you're like backing up to it and you actually go over the side of the mountain. That was pretty exhilarating the first time I did it, because it was like, is this rope going to hold me? And there's nothing but splat on the other side if it doesn't. But as I think more and more about my life and those exhilarating moments, I start to realize I get as much exhilaration out of seeing other people thrive as I do my own experiences. I remember as a preacher, the first time someone put their faith in Jesus while I was preaching, it was exhilarating to see God work in and through that. I remember some of the moments of accomplishments in my wife's life and my daughter's life, and those bring me joy. And even in the life of our church here, just last Sunday we had our inaugural servant appreciation banquet, and hearing the stories of faithful people and how they serve God and serve others, it was a good night just to hear all of those. Jesus said, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I don't know if abundantly means exhilarating, but there's something to that when you follow Jesus, that life isn't just a, you know. There's a survey that Gallup poll, you know, they, I don't know how they do it, take polls of people. In January of this year, they surveyed enough people in the United States to conclude that 85% of Americans are satisfied with their personal life. That's pretty high. But only 17% are satisfied with the direction of the country. Maybe that's the truth, right? I think it tells us two things. One, we can still do pretty good regardless of what's going on around us, right? And two, maybe we need to watch less news because it's just depressing, right? But in that survey, it kind of tried to get at what is it about people that have a very satisfied life. They said the number one factor of the ones they studied and those that had a very satisfying life were those who attended religious services weekly. Over income, over education, folks that were engaged in exercising their faith regularly, weekly, had a very satisfied personal life. So for those who follow Jesus, it looks like he's living up to his promise of having a life that is abundant, or fulfilling that promise, at least in those who answered this survey. Well, today we're going to look at a story or a scene from the book of Acts. If you got a Bible, I invite you to open it, or if you've got a phone, you can turn it on or open it up. Might check the ringer. I did that right before I came up. I was like, oh, my ringer's still on. I'm glad I didn't get a text. But open up a Bible app or a website if you'd like to read along. We're going to look at Acts chapter 9. And it's going to look at a story of an abundant life that got a drastic disruption. Maybe seemingly impossible to overcome, but where God's Spirit worked in and through that disruption to bring others to faith. If you were with us last Sunday, if you want to catch up, our sermons and worship services are online on YouTube and Facebook. But we looked at the story of Saul in Acts, the first part of Acts chapter 9, where he went from being a persecutor of the church and of Christians to having an encounter with the resurrected Jesus, and he put his faith in him, and he began to be a follower of Jesus and even an advocate for others to follow Jesus. And we saw a little bit about what that meant. And he went on to start living out this mission, or the great commission that Jesus gave to the church, to go and make disciples of all people. But today we're going to pick up a parallel story with another disciple or follower of Jesus named Peter. Peter, you know, journeyed with Jesus while he had his ministry on earth, and then he had the moment where he was like, nope, I don't know Jesus. And then after Jesus' resurrection, he re-engaged and he fully followed him. And he began to be an advocate or live out this mission of making disciples of others. We find Peter in the town of Lydda. Lydda, and he encounters a man named Aeneas, who'd been paralyzed for 8 years, and empowered by God's Holy Spirit, Peter heals him, this paralyzed man for 8 years, to where he can walk again. And news of that spreads, and so we pick up the story in Acts chapter 9, verse 36, and we'll read down through verse 43. Follow along with me, and the words should also be on the screen. There was a believer in Joppa named Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. And she was always doing kind things for others and helping the poor. About that time, she became ill and she died. Her body was washed for burial and laid in an upstairs room. Verse 38, but the believers had heard that Peter was nearby in Lydda. So they sent two men to beg him, please come as soon as possible. So Peter returned with them. And as soon as he arrived, they took him to the upstairs room. The room was filled with widows who were weeping and showing him the coats and other clothes that Dorcas had made for them. But Peter asked them to all leave the room. Then he knelt and he prayed. And turning to the body, he said, get up, Tabitha. And she opened her eyes. When she saw Peter, she sat up. He gave her his hand and he helped her up, and then he called in the widows and all the believers, and he presented her to them. The news spread through the whole town, and many believed in the Lord. And Peter stayed a long time in Joppa, living with Simon, the tanner of hides. This is the word of God for the people of God, and we say, thanks be to God. Well, this passage, in especially in verse 40, we see the power of Jesus, resurrected Jesus, working through Peter. Peter knelt. Peter prayed, and inspired by the Holy Spirit, commanded Tabitha to rise. Get up, he said. And when she saw him, she sat up. And then he helped her to stand up, and then he presented her alive to the people who loved her again. It's important to note in this passage a couple of theological understandings, a distinction in what happened here. So she was dead, but he resuscitated her. So we might think of resuscitation kind of like we put the paddles on somebody and bring them back to living again. Is different than the resurrection, okay? What Jesus experienced was the bodily and spiritual resurrection, and he eventually ascended to heaven. But what Tabitha experienced was a healing, a bodily healing, to where she was resuscitated to return to life. Of Tabitha, the best we know, went on to eventually die. And Tabitha, as a follower of Jesus, like you, if you follow Jesus, will be eligible for the ultimate resurrection in the second coming of Jesus. And so this was not a resurrection of Tabitha, but a resuscitation or a healing of her body. But the healing of Tabitha is similar to the resuscitation or healing we saw Jesus do to Lazarus. You may remember that story. It's in John 11. Peter healing of the man that was paralyzed also paralleled a healing of Jesus of a paralytic man, or a paralyzed man, rather, in Mark 2. And so we see fulfilling what Jesus had promised. Listen to these words. I tell you the truth, he says, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works, because I am going to be with the Father. And so Peter's ministry, living by the power of the Holy Spirit in him, is doing these same kind of things we saw Jesus do. That's the power of the resurrection, to give life. God's Holy Spirit power working in you and through you to do the good works that he's invited, equipped, and called you to do. And so we're going to look at a bit more depth this story of Tabitha's life and her healing, and what it means by the power of the resurrected Jesus. If you got your worship bulletin, it's a good time to take it out or look along in there. There's some place for you to take notes or to fill in the blanks, and you can also reference these scripture verses for later. Might take them home and study and be like, what'd that guy say about? And then you can know what I said. Number one, Jesus risen to give life, to fully live. To fully live. Acts 9:36 says there was a believer in Joppa named Tabitha, and she was always doing kind things for others and helping the poor. She was living a full life as a follower of Jesus. Has there ever been a time in your life where you thought, man, this is just pretty good. I like my life. Like, it's going along pretty good. I hope nothing disrupts this, because this is pretty good. You're like almost cruise control. And then lo and behold, something comes along and boom, blows it up. Could be a little bit of a thing like a pothole. It could have been like the bridge is out. I got to take a whole another detour, right? And your life changed dramatically. And you're like, at first, oh no. But in hindsight, maybe years later, you're thinking, thank God. Right? Maybe a lost job that led you to a better job. Maybe even an unexpected child that made you a mother for the first time. You know, there's some really famous people that just did a major shift in their life after they were grown up. I looked these up. Jeff Bezos was pursuing a career as a computer programmer before he started the world famous Amazon at 31. I guess he's like richest or second richest man in the world. Vera Wang, anybody follow her fashion? Y'all know that name? I've heard of it. I don't know. I'm more of a Levi's guy. But anyway, Vera Wang was a figure skater and a journalist before at 40 decided to enter the fashion business and became one of the world's premier designers. And this, some of y'all identify with this. I think I do. Colonel Sanders. 62 years old when he started his first franchise, leaving behind being a lawyer, a gas station operator, and a railroad worker to franchise his first KFC. And we thank God for Colonel Sanders. But too many times you're tempted to focus on what you were instead of what God wants you to be. And that's a problem when it leaves you in a life of sin, of rebellion against God, or maybe just stuck in an attitude of things just can't get any better. So today, I want you to know, whatever circumstances you're in or what might have been, God wants you to have an abundant life. A good life, and a life that does good. Tabitha, we read, was a follower of Jesus. Her name means, I like this one, fast female gazelle. You know what a gazelle is? They're fast. I don't really know. I've never been to the petting zoo where they had gazelles. I guess they can't catch them and put them in the, anyway. They're fast. I guess the fastest or one of the fastest things on the wherever they're at. But she was a doer. She got things done. Tabitha did lots of good. And there's a term in the Greek for this that's in the original Greek New Testament that's pleres or pleros. It means abounding, abundant, very many, or numerous. And she lived a life like God intends for us. To abound or be abundant or do a number of good things. And so if our life is kind of stuck or has been interrupted, it doesn't mean God doesn't want you to be a part of His good. God wants a life, one abounding and always doing good. And so today I invite you to consider what's holding you back from that good. With the resurrection power of Jesus, knock that barrier out of the way. Give life to fully live. Number two, give life to value everyone. Give life to value everyone. Verse 38 and 39 says, but the believers. She was dead, but they said, but they'd heard that Peter was nearby. And so they sent two men begging him, please come. And so Peter returned. The Bible teaches from the very beginning in Genesis 1:27 that we're all created in the image of God. You are an image bearer. The fancy theological term for that, if I can say it right, is Imago Dei, the image of God. So your life is valuable to God. That's why Peter healed the paralytic. The world says the paralyzed folks aren't worth much because what can they do? But God's love said, Peter, go and heal this guy. And the love and the actions of God through Peter said, you're worth it. News of that kind of love spreads. And so the people that were in Joppa who knew Tabitha knew they loved her. They valued her. We don't know her full story, but some assume she might have been a widow. Maybe even alone in the world. But they loved her, and so they sent for Peter. And Peter, the man of God, they thought, surely he'll do something or at least be present with us. And they begged him. They begged him to please come. Implying the value of her life to them. Her value began when she was created in the image of God. Her value was reflected back to God when she put her faith in Jesus, and her value was reaffirmed when they said, please come and do something. And Peter confirmed it again when he came. You see, in Acts chapter 9 and 10, there's sort of this, do y'all remember the story of Jonah? Y'all remember that? There's a big fish in Jonah. Well, the key thing of that Jonah story is how he got there. Like, he got there because he was said, God said, come on over here and preach to these people. And Jonah said, I don't want to preach to these people. I don't even think they're real people. I don't think God could love them. What is he talking about? I'm going to go the other way. And he wound up swallowed up in the big fish. And God says, are you sure you want to run from me? Right? And so that's the story of Jonah. And we see an allusion to that here in Acts chapter 9 and 10, where the church is trying to wrestle with, is God's love, is the gospel for everyone, or is it just for us? And so Peter, who grew up a Jew, God works in him and is saying, yes. Earlier, what we looked at last Sunday, where Saul, who had persecuted the church, God says, I've got something even for him. You see, in this chapter, Peter bucks the cultural trend and even the religious trend and proclaims with his Spirit-inspired actions, the gospel of Jesus is for all. Against religion, it says it's just for the Jews. This example says God's love is for all the Gentiles too. Against the idea that might makes right, all means the paralyzed too. And against a culture and even religious that had a patriarchy. And on this Mother's Day, all especially means women, too. The give life, the resurrected Jesus says there's value in every one. Number three, give life so others believe. Give life so others believe. Verse 42 says, the news spread through the whole town, and many believed in the Lord. The purpose of healing Tabitha wasn't so much to get her back to serving. At first, we may see that, because it says, here's the things she did. But it doesn't say excuse me, it doesn't say at the end of this, we don't hear mention of her ministry work after that, right? You think, well, my life is about what I can do. And many believed in the Lord. The purpose of healing wasn't so much to restore her to her life or to her work or to her ministry roles that she held. The purpose was to spread the good news of Jesus. It says though that the whole town believed. The original Greek word there for believe is pisteo, and it means to believe or entrust or become a follower of Jesus. They weren't just trying to convince people of the miracle that happened to Tabitha, like, oh, she was dead, now she's awake and up and going. The miracle spoke for itself. The belief that God wanted to work through this was so that others would believe in the resurrected Jesus and follow him. You see, they didn't just believe Tabitha was healed. They believed Jesus was the resurrected Son of God. You see, God can use bad circumstances, a disruption in our life. Anybody ever had a bad circumstance in their life? Anybody? Raise your hand up if you had a bad circumstance, right? God can use bad circumstances to birth faith in you or in others. In fact, the arrest, the persecution, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus, they set the precedent for how God uses the most dire of circumstances to give birth to faith. The key is whether or not the blessing of God will lead to faith. Faith in you. Like where church is not just a hobby you do, but following Jesus is your life. And whether or not the blessing God gives to you will lead to faith in others. You see, we have the blessing of living in an amazing town called Leeds, Alabama. We also have the blessing of living in an amazing country. But if I'm honest, most of us Christians are living more for ourselves than we are to see faith in others. By that I mean, a majority of our churches are declining. We're not seeing new faith. We're seeing a decline in the number of people that are coming to faith and those that are attending. The church, in fact, is growing fastest on continents where the material or the physical blessing of God seems like it's further from the people than most Americans enjoy. The challenge, or maybe I'd say the opportunity for us, for churches in America, for our church in Leeds, Alabama, is will we live our lives of abundance for ourselves, or will we do that in a way that sees others put their faith in Jesus? Will we live our lives abundantly in faith so that others may believe and follow Jesus? Or will we simply consume the blessing that God has given us and let the momentum of a movement of God kind of fade? Maybe even die out in us. The best part about today is we get to decide. You get to decide, will you respond to the blessing of God? Put your faith in Jesus and follow him. Church, we get to decide, will we just be consumers of the blessing of God, or will we be proclaimers of that good news to others? It's my prayer, it's my life calling to be a proclaimer of that good news. That the abundant life for everyone is available to everyone who believes in Jesus. To spread that to the whole town, to the whole country, to the whole world. That's the opportunity for us as a church. And we may be a part of not only receiving that blessing, the new life that God has given us, but that it would be, our lives would be a response to God and a witness to others. May it be so today. Give life so others may believe. Let's pray. God, thank you so very much for your good news. Excuse me. Thank you for the good news of Jesus. Thank you for the abundant life that you've promised. And God, thank you so much for that abundance in our lives. God, I pray that you would make that real in those that are hurting or struggling. They're missing your presence even today. God, draw us close to you. Draw us into your abundant life. God, let a part of that, or even the biggest part of that, be that we see and value others. So much so that our life would be more than just a consumer of that abundance, but we would be a life lived that others might believe. So God, I pray that you would bring faith here today, individually, to us as a church, and let it multiply through our community and around the world. In Jesus' holy name I pray, amen. We're going to continue in worship through Holy Communion. Communion began on the night where Jesus sat with his disciples just before he was arrested. He took the bread and he said, "Eat this. This represents my body that's given for you." At the end of the meal, he took the cup and he said, "Drink this. This represents the shed blood, the sacrifice for you, for the forgiveness of sins, for everyone who earnestly believes in me." And so today we look back on that work of Jesus and we put our faith in that. His sacrifice on the cross was a sacrifice for our sins, that we don't have to pay the consequences for that. But we also today receive Jesus. In this sacrament of communion, we receive him in us, his spirit in us, to live a life of hope until he comes again. And so this table, this communion table, is open to everyone if you earnestly seek a relationship with Jesus. And if there's anything that separates you from that, a sin, a rebellion, a crummy attitude, a forgiveness to someone else that you know God wants you to offer, you can make that a part of your offering to him today and receive his forgiveness, his wholeness, and all of him. God, I pray that you would bless these elements of bread and juice, that they would be, in a spiritual sense, your body and your blood for us. Wash over our sin, forgive us, live within us, have a future in you until you come again. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Our communion elements are served in a cup that has two sides. The top side, most of them are turned up like this. There's a cracker. You open that and eat the cracker and then flip over and peel back, and there's a grape juice, and drink that. You may receive your elements of communion and kneel at the kneeling rails on either side if you'd like to pray, or you may simply return to your seat and receive your elements there. We have a bit of something different today, or I think a fun thing. You might notice there's a bucket of flowers. Is there a botanist in the room can tell me what kind of flowers these are? I don't know. They're pretty flowers. These are for you if you're a mother, or you know a mom that you want to give one to, or you know somebody that might could use some kindness today. So take one or two or three when you come by after you receive the communion and give it. Receive it if you're a mom, or give it to your mom, and then find somebody today that a flower might help express God loves you. They're on either side of the table. Take one as or two or three as you come by today. I want to invite the tech team to come up and receive elements first, and then I'll invite the rest of the congregation to come. Get your elements of communion and grab one, two, or three of these maybe carnations. I don't know. All right, congregation, would you come now, please? Father God, I thank you for the blessing, the faith you've given us to follow Jesus. I thank you for the good news. I thank you for everyone who's received faith and Holy Communion today. God, I pray that you would work in and through us, live a life fully follows you. God, I thank you for the blessing of moms, the blessing of flowers. May you use these as gifts and share that love with those moms and with others today. Pray all this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. I've decided if you couldn't separate and there's like six came out, that was just God's way of saying take an extra blessing with you. I will say this too, when we leave today, set a bucket out by the door. If you didn't get one or want to get an extra one or thought of somebody, hey, I could take this, we'll have a bucket sitting by the door. We're going to dismiss you in just a moment. I want to invite you to know of a couple of things that are coming up. Go in kindness with carnations. I guess these are carnations. I don't know. And give those to a mom, to yourself, or to someone that you can share God's love with. Next Sunday, the 15th, the series continued, Risen for Us All. Next Sunday, we also get the joy of welcoming our new director of youth and worship, Joseph Mendham. Joseph will begin in the office this week and be with us first time on Sunday next week. At the conclusion of this service, the 8:45 worship service, around 9:40-ish, we'll convert this from a worship service into a welcome party, right? A party, a bank. Well, maybe it's not that big, but it'll be a good thing. We'll have some cake and some refreshments and welcome Joseph and his wife, Brianna. And we'll stay for about 15 or 20 minutes. Oh, we got a picture. There's Joseph. And take a picture or you'll get to know him soon in the coming days. But we want to welcome him. And so we'll do that and invite our Sunday school leaders to also be patient if folks kind of drift in after meeting him and his wife next week. With that, I want to invite you to go share the joy. We got a mom with her. And share the love of Jesus. In your life, a life God has invited and equipped you to live abundantly in His joy, no matter the disruptions that you may face. Go and give them, Jesus, and we hope to see you next Sunday. Bye for now.